Okay, welcome everyone. Thank you all for coming, and these guys are going to have some wonderful things to say. I'm David Banks from Luceo Images. I'll be the moderator for the discussion, and the discussion is going to be on the future of documentary photography, or photojournalism, however you want to look at it. And first I'll introduce our distinguished panelists here. We have Bess Greenberg, the director of 25CPW. We have Jim Estrin, a staff photographer at the New York Times and co-editor of the New York Times Lens blog. We have Brian Paul Clamp, the owner and director of Clamp Art. And we have Paul Moakley, deputy photo editor of Time Magazine. Welcome. Okay, so to get things kicked off, as you talk about the future of photojournalism, you undoubtedly have to bring up something that people say again and again about the death of photojournalism, and photography for that matter. It's been proclaimed many times throughout the latter part of the 20th century. The closure of Life magazine in 1972 was thought to be the moment of death to many. And most recently, agency director Neil Burgess called the time of death as August 1st, 2010. And my question to y'all is, does this relatively young medium have a future?
Photography has become, I think, more important, not less important. Certainly, the web is about photography to a large degree. I don't see any less of a need for it. I think we're in an interim period that it's not quite clear how one monetizes it. But at the same time, I think it's easy to forget that documentary photographers never made a living. Photojournalists did sometimes, but documentary photographers never made a living. You know, and you do it out of passion, and I think we're gonna figure it out, I really do.
Wants to take a stab at it next.
I mean, how many times have we heard about the death of painting, you know, since the late 19th century? So it's the same old sort of statement to make that, you know, in many ways just doesn't make a lot of sense. So I certainly see a future for the medium, and I think it's kind of a silly statement.
I think maybe that we defined what photography was a little too early. Like it's a young medium, and we were quick to say what documentary was and quick to say what photojournalism was. And so we now have put up limitations for ourselves as photographers and as a culture, ultimately, I think. But I think now, in this time of uncertainty, there's a whole lot more possibilities. And ultimately, I feel the photographer themselves, like, we have a chance now to define what photography is going to be in the future and to define what it is going to be now. So I definitely see a future for it, and I think it's one that's uncertain, but I think it's filled with possibilities that have been beyond what we could have conceived before.
Yeah, I agree with both of your comments. I definitely don't see photojournalism as dead in any way. I think in a lot of ways, maybe it is defined in too strict of a category, and we kind of have to redefine what it is right now. At work, you know, I've been at my current job for the past year, and it's certainly not dead there. We've published at least two photo essays every month, if not more, online. But in the magazine, which wasn't happening for a long time, and I think things on our end are definitely improving a bit. I know that's not the case everywhere, but we're trying to be positive about it. And, you know, I think the key factor for me is I still see exciting work and I get inspired all the time. And I think people are just have to come up with like new strategies for storytelling and not fall into the same conventions that like are just kind of killing it and making it boring. And that's kind of how I, you know, kind of stand now.
Can I follow up on what Bess said? Because I think you really hit it right. The possibilities are endless. You know, so we have to figure out how to make a living, but every person here can show me their work. You can publish it yourself. It's easy to be seen. When I was young, you couldn't show work. It was hard. And if you didn't live in New York, forget it. There are storytelling possibilities that are beyond what we could have imagined. You know, and as solely as photographers, we were somewhat limited in our capabilities of telling a story, particularly as a photojournalist. No matter how good a storyteller you were, you were often mainly an illustrator. And now on the web and using other media, using audio or video, you can be the author in a way you couldn't be before. So I think that it may be a little scary, but I think it's much more thrilling than it is scary and much more exciting.
You know, one thing I was thinking about before is was it necessarily dying or is photography dead? But I do think photojournalism and documentary might be drowning. You know, there's like a lot, it's not completely dead, but there's so much information out there. As photographers and editors and curators, there's so much overload. We have access to seeing so many different projects and so many different images all of the time. So making things of value, I think, now is what's important. Like focusing on the things that you really connect with as a photographer or as a curator, as an editor, and driving those things forward, because it might be easier to get information and put information out there, but what are we saying with that information? And how are we being responsible as photographers for putting that information out there? Are we making quick projects because we have the tools now to do it, because we have access to do it? Or are we thinking about what will happen with the outcome of putting those projects out there on the web? What they're saying to the public and what they're saying about ourselves as photographers and how we're contributing to the future of the medium in that way.
Wonderful. Well, sounds like we got a pretty good prognosis from you.
Yeah, definitely.
So moving on to the next question, which piggybacks off that one. Quote social media consultant Richard Stacy, hitch your fortunes to information and you will prosper. Chain yourself to the means of distribution and you will die. Each of you are part of this dissemination process in one form or another. How does this statement apply to your respective mediums is my question. And not to pick on you, but since you are part of one of those new dissemination processes, let's start with Jim.
Well, that's exactly the problem, is how do you then, I'm sorry, thanks. How do you make money if you can't do it through distribution? And, you know, there's things like emphasis, which is trying to tackle that. There's Facing Change Documenting America, which is also trying to tackle that. So at first, it would seem when you say that, you say, well, that's it. That's the whole ball game. If you can't make money at distribution, how do you make money? And in music, you know, in MP3s, it's for a lot of people, they lost their ability to make money, but they were able to then make the live concerts be the way to pay. So I believe we are beginning to find ways of doing that. And, you know, there's really very few limits to the web and social media about how to monetize. We have Kickstarter, but, you know, we're at the beginning of this, just the real, real, real beginning.
Yeah, I think it applies the same to, well, not precisely the same, but it affects everyone from photographers to gallery owners to museum curators. And it's responding to all these changes and figuring out how to reach your audience, you know? And that's what we're trying to figure out every day. In some ways, it makes it easier and easier because we're all more and more connected to one another. It's pretty amazing what kind of reach you really have. But figuring out how to harness that in an economical way and a productive way, reaching precisely the right audience, that's important. Yeah, so that's what we're all trying to figure out.
Well, you know, just to answer quite directly, like one of the things that's, I think you definitely have to evolve and just change what you're doing and you know, as a publication or as a place to see photography or kind of put it out there. And, you know, this year we had that whole iPad launch and it's definitely a whole new market for photographers and, you know, we're paying extra for all those images. We can't just run them in the magazine, especially if they're not appearing in the magazine or they weren't shot for assignment. But I think it's just like photography is so incredibly undervalued in a way, but there's also, you know, sometimes you think there's too much of it out there. But it's, I think photographers have to be really kind of strict about how they're pricing themselves and how they value their work. And I think all the photographers out there kind of set that tone. And, you know, it's definitely, it goes both ways, but like, you know, I think we all need photographs, they're all necessary for what we're doing. And I think that's definitely a big part of it.
And, you know, just as a follow-up on that, how, as these new, you know, in your experience anyway, mm-hmm. as these new ways of dissemination evolve, and, you know, like the iPad, mm-hmm. how are photographers approaching you about, you know, the value of that work distributed in these new ways?
Well, it's so new, it's still being worked out. Like, the very first month I started my job, a photographer approached me with a story, and it was completely made for the iPad. It was a video, it was a piece with photographs, video, audio. It was like the perfect platform for it. And it was brand new, we kind of just had to figure it out, and you know, it's just gonna keep changing, but we paid her like a video rate, like what we would pay someone to go out and do a short film. So, but I think it's going to change. And, there's a different day rate for shooting photos, and there's a different rate for shooting videos. And when you shoot video, you have to like edit it and make a complete package. So sometimes it's just one flat rate. It's different for everything. It depends how long the piece is. So I don't want to put prices out there.
And we're going to actually have some time for audience questions at the end. Sorry. No, we certainly appreciate it.
And we definitely want your questions.
Let's see. Well, for us, I know here at the gallery, for example, things like the internet make this completely possible. Coming into an old Christides, I couldn't really afford to send out mailers to everybody and invite people around and send out examples of work to everyone. So I'm sure most of you were able to come here tonight by finding out from some way of the web and saw images on the web. So while I think that's excellent, I also feel that ultimately, when the work that you're putting out loses a certain value, again, back to that, or depth to it, that will make the audience connect to it, then you're gonna lose money. Because what I've found here is that people wanna feel connected to work. They don't wanna just see it. We're used to seeing images on Facebook, we're used to seeing images all over the web and seeing them quick and being able to get it for free. So when people are used to being able to get images for free, they're not necessarily gonna be quick to pull out their money to pay you for a service that they're used to getting for free. But what I see about people coming in here is when they're able to maybe connect to an artist or connect to a photographer, have a discussion about it, it then leads to something. I think people are hungry for that connection. And what I think everyone, the reason why I became a photographer myself was because I felt that photography had the capability to bring people together. And although the information on the web is great and it spreads and it's quick, and it can bring people together because they all see the same things, it doesn't necessarily bring people together ultimately. And I think in some ways, if we think out of the box and start to unite people and based on ideals perhaps, or values, or again, I guess its possibilities are up to everything that different people value, then I see people making some kind of investment together into the future. We had talked a little bit about collaborating with different photographers and how maybe collectives help out in that sort of way. So you might be able to reduce your own costs, and instead of thinking in terms of making more money, thinking of reducing your own costs to keep a value and keep a passion alive.
Excellent. Going on to our next question, and then this, and again, these just kind of dig deeper and deeper into this idea. Based on that last statement, researcher and industry blogger David Campbell claims that while some of the distributors, i.e. newspapers and magazines, in their current form, don't get me wrong, may die, the information which he defines as photojournalism and documentary photography is very much alive. What are your thoughts on this? I'll start with Paul.
Sure. I think it's very much alive, and it doesn't even have to be like in technology. Some of the most exciting work I see is just in book format, and I think like photographers have changed what they're doing with books so much in like the last couple of years. It's almost like I kind of compare going to the bookstore as to like what it used to be like to go to a record shop, and I used to hear like tons of great bands, and it's the bookstore has kind of turned into that, but it's just, they're so much more challenging. I think it's also like, you know, something that you said about the value. It's like you could really see it in sort of a format that feels more valuable, and you could connect with it in such a nice way. That's why I think it's kind of vital right now and alive. It's kind of almost like a response to how we're seeing pictures on the internet. And the same things, I think, happening with photographers who are going into like an installation-based practice in galleries. That's something that I think is like really vital and alive in photography, and changing the gallery world a bit. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. There are more photography books being published than ever. And there are so many fantastic publishers that really specialize in photography. And photographers are at such a great advantage to artists who work in other media, because so many more photography books are produced than, you know, painting books or sculpture books, because photography lends itself so well, you know, to the printed page. And other than working through, you know, commercial publishers, there are so many great opportunities to self-publish work at this point and then really have total control over your project, kind of like what you were talking about before with video and other things. So I think there's some really exciting opportunities in that sense to really get your story out there and have it told in the way, you know, that you want it told.
And I think there's a lot of different ways to distribute photos, obviously self-publishing. But, you know, think about the Darfur photos projected all over Europe and in New York, you know, 40 feet high. I'm sorry. Think about the Darfur photos, you know, projected 40 feet high. You know, think about, you know, Bass Track. There's so many ways we can engage people that are different. I think the world is not less visual. It's more visual. I see only the greatest possibilities and things that we haven't thought of. If so when I'm 20, I'm 53, and, you know, basically the gallery world was the same it had been 10 years before. The publishing world was the same pretty much. We lost life a few years before, so that was the end of photojournalism when I was young. And there's very little changes. So now, not only are there potentially more possibilities, but you can actually make the possibility. So not only do you have photographs to publish, but your ideas are incredibly valuable. That's really the currency on the web, is ideas and how well you can execute it. And if you have ideas and you can execute them well, you can do anything. You know, what you could have done it would have taken 100 people a year to do just 7-8 years ago, you can now do with 3 people in 3 months. I think you can do absolutely anything you can conceive of practically because of these changes, because of social media, because of the web. And so, yeah, we absolutely have to figure this out. But I don't see photos being less important. I think they're more important. I think they're actually the currency, in a sense, that information now circles around. They're not just a little thing to break up the print anymore. They're now actually sometimes more important than the words, and it's certainly how we, you know, at the Times, if we're going to engage readers, we have to do it through the photos, and that's a complete reversal of what it was 10 years ago.
Well, I think that if, you know, magazines and newspapers were capable of hiring all of us right now, this space probably wouldn't exist. You know, the reason that this space came about was because I am a photographer, and without the possibility of finding tons of work and being able to fund myself, I felt like there was a need for another kind of place where photographers could come together and share their work and show their work. Now, this used to be an old Gristides, so I'm not saying that everybody should go out and open up a space and work out an arrangement with the real estate people, but I think that in times when things look dim, there's definitely doorways that go to other places. And I'm not saying that newspapers and magazines aren't the way to go, but as we feel, if that avenue isn't working out for us, it's definitely, definitely the time is now to do something on your own. If you have an idea, I feel like now is the time to follow that. I just hope that, you know, something that people can take away from the evening coming together and talking to each other isn't that things are, you know, struggling all around and photography is wearing itself thin, but that this is actually the time for us to create our own possibilities and determine the future of photography as for ourselves on our own.
So I think the key is not to be afraid.
Yeah, no fear.
I'm not saying being Pollyannish, really, but you just can't be afraid. You can't move forward out of fear.
Yeah, following the love of why you really got into photography in the first place, whether it be connecting with other people or creating images or whatever it might be, the love that you have for it, is to follow that through now. This is the time to take the risk. This is the time to step forward and say, hey, I have an idea, or hey, let's talk about this.
So this is building off something that a lot of you have been talking about, these new means of distribution, whether they be, or these new means of funding, really, whether it be assignments that are in projects that are iPad-based, or whether it be emphasis or flatter, or any of a number of these different things. The internet just offers a mode of distribution with global reach at virtually no cost. And this has the potential to effectively replace the dying distribution modes. But at what point does this translate into funding for the photographers, the content producers? And since you brought up emphasis.
That's great.
Again.
Yes. Can you tell me what it is for people who might not be familiar with it? Do you guys know what it is?
I don't.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, help me out here, but it's an attempt to marry the idea of funding the process with crowdsourcing money, so that it's what they're trying to do is recognize that it's harder to fund the product and sell it. So if you have a personal relationship with the photographer through emphasis, you can choose, you know this photographer, you believe in the project, you can choose to be a funder of this. It might be, I don't know what they're going to decide, for $5 a month or $10 a month. It'll be a 6-month project, let's say, but you follow them. They do multimedia, they do live chats, you know, you have email correspondences. So, you know, like Kickstarter, you're helping out a project you believe in, but you're getting something out of the process. And the theory is that people will be willing to pay a small amount, enough that will fund a photographer to do the project they want to do. And in return, you get a more intimate and different kind of reporting experience than just the end experience of photographs. Is that your understanding?
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much? Okay. So then what was the question beyond that?
And you know, I'll open up the question a little bit, which, you know, so obviously we can't sit up here and predict the future about how these different modes will actually, how these personal direct funding methods will actually come to materialize, but do you find that there's more photographers out there that are finding success in building personal relationships with those that consume their work? You know, photographers used to be, you know, the lofty National Geographic photographer up on the pedestal that you never, you know, is this kind of intangible right. person.
Well, there's this group called Luceo that, you know, pretty much does that. And it's part of a, I think it's more than just promotion. I think it's part of also how you believe, you know, what you're yearning for in relationships, in communication. So I think the answer is yes, it's very possible to do because of social media, to use those, to build those relationships. And certainly to, it also, it promotes yourself and I think makes for profounder relationships with your audience, potentially. And, you know, you're probably not, didn't think you were going to get rich at this. You're in it to communicate. So it's an additional way of communicating. But the question of at what point do you harness that to make money and how we do it, be perfectly honest, I don't know. If I didn't know, you know, we wouldn't be here doing this. You know, I wish I did. I think that there are, you know, there are bright glimmers of things going on. I think, you know, what you have done, you know, what Luceo has done as far as building Luceo into a business, and, you know, I think done without cynicism completely, but using those type of communication tools to allow you to be more likely to make a living. What Tony Soir and David Burnett and others, Alan Chin, are doing with Facing Change as well. You know, a different funding mechanism because they're, but a mixed funding mechanism of both private foundation kind of money and business relationships. So I think it's possible, it's easier probably, you may have to define your own business setups at this point because there's not a lot of models to work on. So you may sort of have to figure this out yourself to a degree, but I see some people doing it. But I don't have an answer that'll make us all happy.
Mm-hmm. But I'm sure one of you.
I don't definitely don't have any answers to help you make a lot of money in any way, but to, you know, the people I work with and maintain relationships with have definitely, I don't know, I just feel like a lot of photographers maybe just spread themselves too thin. And if somebody just writes me a letter and sends me just a print or something, you know, that usually gets my attention. If you email me and I don't know who you are, I get too many emails. But like, that's just like the beginning of what I think, you know, you can start personal relationships with the editors you want to work for or where you think your work fits in. I just think it's good not to spread yourself too thin and waste all your money, all your time. Your time is like so important and all your resources, just like trying to reach everyone in the world and buying into all these things. Like you can buy these lists and promotional things and you can spend tons of money making cards. Just keep it small and just try to reach the people who you think are doing work that is important to you. And then hopefully they'll respond to the work that you think is, that you're making and you think is also important. And that's the way most of my relationships start. I'm not on Facebook. I don't, you know, I don't do much like social media, even though I'm kind of being thrown into it more now. But I think, you know, it's just keep it small and personal. And eventually I think things click. And also the most important thing at the core of it is like just keeping your work really personal. And I think making sure, like, I think that's like the most unique thing you could do. And almost everyone I've ever hired is probably from their personal work. I usually don't see photographers and look at their tear sheets and go, oh, you can work for us now. that's like, I don't think really ever happened for me. Usually I'll see your project on your family or something from your hometown, and that's the thing that usually kind of makes me remember you and I find unique. So that would be my answer to just that sort of thing.
Great.
And I need to add that I remember being a young photographer in the first advanced studies program at the International Center of Photography they had. At the International Center of Photography in their first advanced studies program 30 many years ago. And I knew very few people who were truly making a living. I think there were 200 to 300 photographers who were making a living off of magazines, a certain amount of international reportage thrown in with corporate work, and those positions are mostly gone. Absolutely, that's problematic. But most of the people I knew, including many of the people I truly admired, were not making a very good living. And many people who we still admire went through their careers concentrating on their own work. Maybe not making brilliant decisions business-wise, teaching or whatever, but I just don't know that. And again, it's photography, photojournalism, documentary, but I just don't know people who are getting rich. I know some people who are making a living. The newspaper jobs aren't there as much, but the vast majority of them paid terribly, and everyone left by the time they were 35 because they needed an adult salary. So, not to belittle the problems we have, but I think it's wrong to think there was a golden age where every photographer made a living. That's simply not true. People dropped out year after year after year. So the people I knew when I was 21, fewer were photographing when they were 25, fewer when they were 30, and the people who were around at 40, and my colleagues who are older than me in their 60s say it's a handful of people they know they worked with, if they're 60, are still working. I'm not saying good or bad, but it's not like there was, it was different. It wasn't as confusing because you knew the playing field. But people often, went off, did their work, tried to do business. Often photographers were really bad at business, almost everyone I ever met of my age. And they did it badly. And, there were fashion photographers making a living. There were commercial photographers, there were advertising photographers, a handful of gallery, no, really then there were no gallery photographers making a living, I take it back. but they just weren't the documentarians, and they weren't really, to a large degree, the photojournalists. I just needed to say that. It wasn't, a gold, maybe before my time it was, when life was going, maybe there was a golden era, but not in my life so much. What?
There just weren't that many photographers as there are now at that time.
Yeah,
also,
that's probably true.
It's the institutionalization of it all has made so many more people kind of working in the practice.
I think turning them out
thing.
Of schools.
It's like, I don't know. I think I hope that the amount of photographers that just makes it better. It's like
And so going out, that kind of leads us talking about this personal work and, which is undoubtedly has built-in funding problems. It leads us to our next question, which is, again, using ourselves as an example, but Luceo has found some success in partnering with its photographers to offset marketing and production costs. And the question is, as similar business structures become more and more prevalent, you feel this business model will continue to be effective in helping to produce personal work? And
I'm doing personal work. Well, I think the cooperative or collective is an excellent way to go, because I think in one aspect we spread ourselves too thin, a lot of what Paul and Jim was saying before. And so now we have all these different tools in our hands and we're like, all right, well, now they want sound, so I got to have audio in my pocket. And now I want to be able to shoot photographs and video at the same time. And so we spend a lot of time learning new software, organizing our files, having our brain overloaded on that sort of thing, and dealing a lot with that. I think at any opportunity you can to specialize what you want to do, to say, this is what I'm good at, this is what I'm passionate about, I want to take still photographs, or I want to do visual storytelling in video, and really hone your skill in that. What Paul was saying about keeping it personal, I kind of feel that it's not necessary, it's good to be realistic. I don't think it's a bad thing if you have a group of people that you all work together, so one person is going to be working on sound, one person's going to be working on video, one's doing stills. You take pressure off of each other, and then you come together with a product, and you can spend more time devoting the value to your one skill set. I know that we can all do lots of things now, and we have the technology at our hands, but I think that ultimately the thing that we really want to get at is what each of us values most in it, right? And if we spend a lot of time on the surface, skimming the surface, we're not going to get as good quality of work, and we're not going to be as satisfied to reach our personal work. I feel like if you work together in teams now to provide a final product, which might suit an iPad application, I know that a lot of photographers might not be able to just give time that sort of thing right away. But if you work with a bunch of other people and then put a product together, then you have more time to devote to your other work. And I'll also say, I think it's important that you know, being realistic in the times, it's not such a bad thing to devote some of your time making money in the photography world, perhaps, but a lot of people might use the camera to make money and it's not something they're passionate about. But maybe there are other things that we're passionate about in this time of uncertainty. If we make money to finance projects or to be able to spend a month in the summer following our personal work, and then put that quality body of work out there, I feel like that might end up making a bigger difference than spreading ourselves thin and never being able to really cut it and get to your personal work. This is a time, I don't want to be, it's not possible to just make money shooting the camera, but I know that I know a lot of friends, and even with myself, spending a lot of time shooting doesn't necessarily mean I'm being fulfilled. So I think the time now is to focus on getting back to what really fulfills each of us as a photographer. And although we might make money Monday through Friday doing something else, you're still a photographer. You're still working towards ultimately putting a body of work out there that you really believe in and care about. So maybe redefining what it is a photographer these days isn't somebody who has a press pass all the time.
Yeah, and to build on that, I mean, I often tell someone who's 18 or 20 or 22, you know, if they want to be a photographer, I say that you should do it if you have to do it, if you don't have any choice. If it's between that and another opportunity and you aren't sure, you should probably do the other opportunity. It's hard. I think it always was hard, actually. It's harder and less certain as far as how you make money. But the question is, why are you doing it? You know, you're not doing it because it was that, or being, investing in, you know, being a broker on Wall Street and you figured, I'll make as much money, it'll be a little more fun. You know, you're doing it, you know, you're doing it because you have to do it. You know, you're doing it because it matters to you as a form of communication, that you love it and that you have something to say and you believe you can say it and you believe you can communicate to people, and hopefully you enjoy it as well. That it's just a fabulous thing to do. And so I think, you know, going at it from that way, and I don't want photography to end up being like being a painter or being a dancer, or, you know, I don't want you to have to be a waiter to be a photographer. Not that there's anything wrong with being a waiter, but if it's not your profession, you know, that's what dancers do. They you know, that's what, you know, painters do. I mean, not most of them aren't making a living. I want you to make a living. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that, why are you doing this? What's the best way to accomplish it? And what's the best way then within that? How do I support myself so I can do this in the best way possible?
And now it's just the paths aren't as clear and you have to be more creative, but it's not a reason not to do it. I mean, if you're not making a living, that's not a reason not to do it. People have always been photographers and doing other things. I mean, Gene Richards has never made a living. Never. He was one of my favorite photographers, one of the most famous photojournalists, and you know, I don't think he's ever had a year that he made as much as a New York City garbage man. I highly doubt that. And probably in most of his years, he hasn't made half of it. Again, not saying that's the best business model. I'm merely saying that he does it because he loves doing it. Mm-hmm. And somehow, because he's so brilliant, he ends up making, you know, some money despite himself. But, you know, really the essence is what are we doing and why are we doing it?
You know, I think like targeting and specializing is extremely important. But I think, you know, versatility is also key. Yes, and you have to be careful not to spread yourself too thin. But I think about the photographers on my gallery's roster with the most success are those that are able to do a few different things at the same time. They do editorial work. They may do some commercial work, and that work helps fuel their personal work. And most of the time, all that work is intertwined. Maybe, you know, someone like Paul assigns a story to them that eventually will grow into a fine art project, or maybe they have an idea, you know, for a personal project, and then they're able to get, you know, editors who believe in their work to assign them stories related to that, you know, to help them produce it and help them realize it. So again, being able to think creatively, you know, and to approach things from many different angles is sort of a key, you know, to be able to accomplish what you're passionate about.
Yeah, I don't know if I have that much to add to this question. I think I kind of spoke to it a little bit earlier, but I agree with you. And there are lots of photographers I know who are like, who work as librarians, and I've scheduled their shoots around their full-time jobs. And, you know, and maybe I only work with that person once or twice a year, but their personal work is so specific and special that I will go out of my way to hire them and go out of my way to make the job work with them if I think I could help them and kind of support their career. So I think that's totally, you know, an honorable thing to do. You don't have to be a full-time working photographer and make your entire income from it. And, you know, and it is eye-opening to like, you know, I've been working as a photo editor for about 13 years now, and you meet some of your legends and idols in photography, and those people are like still struggling in their 60s and or however old they are, and you know they did it because it was the only choice they kind of had, and they just did it, and they kind of, you know, just kept it going, and I think that's, you know, alone is incredible, and hopefully it you know, it pays off, and I believe it does in a lot of cases, but it just shows, like, you know, just persistence, I think, does you know, show over, does pay off, and you know, the good work does come through in time. And another thing I'd have to say is just take your time with things. I think a lot of people rush. They come up with work and they're like, oh, I spent 3 days shooting this, and it's a whole entire portfolio. And I'm like, don't think this is quite ready. And that happens way, you kind of like giggle, but like that happens all the time. And it's like, I want to, you know, put some years into it. Think about it. You know, stew with it for a while. It's really important. People are just rushing, and I think that has a lot to do with the way we like treat pictures, and we just throw them up on the web, and I don't think, you know, there are pictures that belong on the web and sets of pictures that belong in different places, but I think maybe that has a lot to do with it. But just take your time, and that's it.
So all of you are, as gallery owners or curators of photography in some form or fashion, how have you seen the photographic art world change in recent years, and what role does documentary photography play in those changes?
I mean, things have changed so phenomenally for photography in the past 15 years. Finally, it's sort of been validated in many ways as a real art form, and it's finally highly collectible. Photography wasn't really all that collectible in the 1970s, so that's changed. And now, finally, the prices have started to, come to par with other media. So that's a big difference. But something that we've talked about before, too, there are more photographic artists than ever. Thankfully, there are more photography galleries, or at least galleries that deal with photography. Any serious contemporary art gallery, in 2011, has to have photography as part of the component of what they show. But it is a challenge. There are so many photographers being churned out, by art schools that it is highly competitive. The way that the art world works, I think, is still fairly similar, to the way it always has been. But it's like these changes in technology and distribution and how you reach your clients and how you communicate with your clients has changed. And also just geographically where your clients are located. One of my biggest collectors is a guy in India who I've never met. Who just buys everything, over the internet. And he's a voracious collector. And I enjoy his emails, but I don't think I've ever even had a telephone conversation with him. So in that sense, that's how things have changed.
I just think, historically, there's more photography in museums than ever. They're usually the most packed places in the museum now. If you, go to the show that's up at the Met right now, there's the Steichen, there's some group show. It's they're always packed. When you saw the Americans at the Met, it was completely packed, and the painting galleries, you could have the painting all to yourself. But it's just respected differently. I think photography's come into its time. I think a perfect example is of somebody who's indicative of all the changes is Alex Soth. If you look at where his career has gone, he has work at Gagosian, and then today on the New York Times, he has this amazing, it's not even a photography piece, it's a multimedia piece. And it's he's kind of working in all these different platforms and I think really pushing sort of the bounds of what you could do with pictures and as a photographer, and not just kind of categorizing himself as strictly as a photographer. And I think just a really good example for everyone, and definitely shows kind of, I think, where things are out right now.
Well, one thing I've definitely noticed here, I don't have many years of experience to speak about how things have changed in the gallery world, but one thing that I think is important to note is that a lot of people who come to me are ready to put their hands on things and take part in it. And I think that's important. I don't know with Brian, with you, but for a lot of people that are coming to me, and maybe what this space is also about, is it gives that possibility for coming in, and if we don't have tons of funding, it's all right, let's get dirty, let's roll our sleeves up and make it happen. And so instead of waiting for somebody to send you that note in the mail that says, I'm going to give you a solo show in this beautiful space right now, people are making it happen and getting their work out there and trying to make the connections on their own. And that's the one thing that I think in the year and a half that this space has been going that's been part of or essential for fueling the space. People's energy coming and putting it towards it. Mopping floors, putting things up on the walls, making sure, wires and things like that. Everyone's ready to take part in that and to make sure an event all comes together. And that's, I think, the one thing I can think of note that's good.
I love the idea of having a photo where people are actually coming just to look at your photo. Not that you have to vie for attention in the, with text or with, on the web and with three other things they can link to directly. It's such a profoundly different experience. And not one that photojournalists really ever had. And now they're starting to, and that's pretty interesting and pretty great and possibly a source of income, which is lovely.
it actually raises a question we probably shouldn't go into depth in, but raises a question of putting photojournalism up on the wall. And, you know, how do you, so, you know, you have this great James Nachtwey photograph, you know, of war and of suffering and viewing it as art. So it does raise other questions, I think, as well, putting it in another context, which is not to say I don't think photojournalism is art or can be art. It's a different world.
Jim, may I just come up with our next panel discussion topic?
Photography and art, okay.
You know, as a closing question, and we will try to take a little bit of time to get a couple questions from the audience, but what advice can you offer to the next generation of photographers in this future of relative uncertainty?
Oh no. I'm just going to repeat myself a little bit again, but just keep it really personal and just try to really target the people that you want to have a dialogue with. And I think eventually that does happen. I think it happened with a lot of the photographers in Luceo. I met you all at different times, most of you. And I got to know your work pretty slowly, and I got to know how you work at all at different paces. And I think that's like the best way to approach it. But just... yeah, take your time with things and be persistent. So that's all I can say. And educate yourself. That's another thing. That's a real pet peeve of mine. Like, and I could go on about this forever, but like if you're a landscape photographer, know the history of landscape photography. You wouldn't be like a journalist and not know who the great writers are. And I find so many photographers come up and you can't really have a conversation with them because they don't look at other photographers and photography, and I find that a little disappointing, and you should really be in the dialogue and know about it, and it's going to only make you a better photographer, so that's my advice.
Yeah, I mean, I'll start with that. I 100% agree. Know where your work fits in within, you know, the cultural landscape, and don't be afraid to look at other artists' work. I know
it's
a lot of
people are afraid. Sometimes they get like kind of competitive,
or there's an anxiety of influence. Yeah. They're afraid they're going to be too overly influenced by looking at other people's work, or they're afraid to show their work because they're afraid it might be, you know, appropriated or what have you. But that's one of the best pieces of advice I can give artists: is share your work with as many other artists as possible. Because a lot of times great opportunities arise out of that. At the gallery, you know, when someone brings work for me to see, the people I trust the most are the artists that are already on my roster. They know me, they understand my aesthetic, and if they're suggesting someone for me to look at, I take that so much more seriously than a client, you know, or a competitor or anyone else. So that is important. And that leads into originally what I was going to say before you made your comments, just figure out how to get as many eyes on your work as possible. Targeting is important, but for emerging photographers, it's all about that exposure. Just figure out how to get your work out there. Of course, and this is a no-brainer, but have a good website, to start with, and then figure out how to promote that website. Whether it's like, you know, every month or every other month, finding an excuse to send out, an email blast to your targeted list of people. Whether you update your website, whether, you know, you're included on a blog, whatever excuse you can find. As Paul said, we do get tons of emails, but so that's another thing is like, I can't believe how many emails I get from photographers that don't have any images in them. So like put an image, you know, the top of this email, because I never remember anybody's names. No, it's totally true. You get this whole thing with text. Yeah, exactly. And if I see an image, then I'll remember the person, and then it'll all make sense. So anyway, so exposure is what I'm talking about. Get yourself in front of people as much as possible, including other artists.
I would say believe in yourself. Be honest in your work. Concentrate on the work. You have to do all the other stuff, but everything comes out of the work and what you have to show. And if, you know, so you need to be true to yourself, be honest with yourself, be true to your subject or your vision, and do that and find the fulfillment in that. And once you have that, then disseminate. But the you know, because as Paul said, what's, you know, there's a lot of good photographers, tons of good photographers. But what's going to make you noticed is when you have something to say, something different to say, or, you know, covering the same story in a different manner. It's the personal work that'll get you noticed for the most part, not your portfolio that shows you can do A, B, C, D, and E. And it's good if you can do all those things, but it just simply doesn't separate you. And I'd much rather be moved and feel something. And maybe, you know, maybe you're not, frankly, your photographs are a little inferior to someone else's photographs, which are organized perfectly and are, you know, perfectly photoshopped and are technically superior in every way, but they have nothing to say. You know, there's lots of that. I don't want to see that. If you have something to say, then I think that's what's important and probably why you're doing it. So concentrate on that and then also branch out and take care of the business that you have to take care of. But it doesn't replace the photography in any way.
I would say to remember why you became a photographer in the first place and to try to drive that forward. And I'm not saying that we've all lost touch with that, but I think that we spend so much energy, like the all of this discussion is a lot revolving around how we keep up, how we keep up, how we keep up. And I don't think that I didn't get into photography in order to keep up with the world around me. I got into it because I saw a certain beauty in the world that I wanted to share with other people. And I believe that would connect people and bring people together. That's my personal reason. So I feel like keep reminding myself why it is I became a photographer in the first place, and if what I'm doing day to day is ultimately making me go in that direction, is bringing me closer to that, is making me feel fulfilled by that. There's so many things, I feel, you know, there's so many things with information these days that we're taking in, and maybe less information is the way to go and to keep it more potent and more valued to yourself, more personal, as Paul and everyone else was saying.
Well, due to time constraints, I think we're just going to be able to take one question from the audience. But don't
feel any pressure at all.
But what I want to emphasize is that, you know, we want this to be an ongoing discussion throughout the night. You know, like Beth says, this, you know, this place is about people coming together and sharing ideas. So we want everyone to be talking about this tonight. And also for the folks that weren't here that you want to pass along this information, the good folks at PhotoShelter were kind enough to sponsor this portion of the evening, and they will be broadcasting this piece on their blog in the coming week. So you can tell folks to look out for that. And who wants to do the one question? All right. I saw the first hand I saw right there.
It's not so much a question but an observation, which I thought might be useful. I bought a photo agency about 7 years ago, and we had 45 staff as representatives of cabinet photographers. We bought 14 other photo agencies. We now have 3,700 photographers and 18 staff. And our turnover is half of what it should have been 7 years ago.
What agency?
It's called PhotoShop. I mean, we've all different agencies, NHKN, Nature Agency, EKN, News Agency.
Uh-huh.
But it goes back to your point. I think that photography now, particularly photojournalism, should come with a massive health warning about the finances of it.
Yeah.
The opportunities are great. It's never the easiest to take a picture. It's going to be easier to get it out.
Wow.
That's a massive cut. Having already cut them consecutively since the professional started every year. So there's so many kids that, you know, see the opportunity of a digital camera, see the opportunity of the web. It's never been easier to go to photo school. All fantastic, all great self-expression, great interest, great learning. But the money side, from where I stand, selling to you guys, actually, is getting harder and harder. And then the business, the guys, the accountants that run your business are then also taking further advantage of the technology, seeing the crowdsourcing of pitches. So they're looking increasingly outside the scope of the professional photographer into the photographer, you know, the person that likes photography.
Yeah.
And so
sure.
You don't need you, Mr. Professional Photographer, anymore.
Yeah.
Wonderful opportunity, but it's the road to sort of in financial ruin. Great love, great intellectual exercise, great to share. But I would just.
I think what you say is true. I didn't mean to imply that it was one impossible to do it now or will not be possible in the future. I'm actually optimistic. I think it's interesting what Luceo is doing in that way, and you know, it's which is trying to do that because distribution is problematic, and you don't have the ability. It's really hard for agencies; they're just suffering really deeply. But to some degree, because of the things you were talking about, and you know, it used to be, so you would distribute slides, you would send them. You were the only source of photos. It was an agency. And now, actually, anyone can distribute. Admittedly, the money is going to often be much less. But so there maybe is a boutique opportunities for other people. And Luceo has relationships where they're distributing.
I agree, there are pretty good companies, but they're very narrow.
You're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah, so you got to really love it. You're a fool if you're going into it for the money. That's it. You know, you have to love doing it.
And so, would anyone else like to comment on this? I mean, I think that it does have to be for that love that we're out there, but there are possibilities. Okay, we'll take. We started a little late, so we'll take one more right up here, and then we're gonna wrap things up.
Okay, I would like to raise a ton of points if I could.
We only got time for one though.
Pick your favorite.
All right, let me take it down to social currency, dollar sign, social change, result, photography. What does it do? What I see is like a culture, it's like everybody's hyperventilating just because there is so much new technology, new possibilities. And the way you use the term photography, I don't even know what you mean anymore, unless you're talking about anybody that gets a camera and throws a picture up somewhere, and there is a difference between the person who has insight, has creativity, always has passion, always has creativity, always has a greater ability to do something with the camera, whether it's a cheap plastic camera or whether it's the most expensive, complicated platform you can get. And I just feel like it's not your fault. I'm probably one of the few people here that was there back in the 60s when there weren't courses in college, and we had to fight just to get photography represented as a discipline, much less as a course. And we're now at such a crucible in this age. To hear the beginning where somebody said, well, photography is really that important. Are you kidding me? It is the language. We need visual literacy, again, more than ever in the schools. I developed a program called Language and Visual Media way back in like 1971. And at that time, I taught the language of filmmaking, how a film makes us feel, how a film seduces angles, perspectives. The same with photography, and we need that more than ever, and I'm talking out the line.
But what's the question?
The question is, I don't understand why this is so pointed toward only money making in a career. I didn't get that.
That's the topic.
Photojournalism, no, if Eddie Adams were here, can you imagine what he would say? Can you imagine if that topic was barnstorm? I mean, no, photojournalism isn't dollars. It isn't always a career.
And I think the topic has been more pointed towards, you know, towards that personal work and towards how this is a medium, and they've just been talking a bit on how that medium is going to continue to proliferate.
I agree with a lot of the things you're saying. I completely agree, and I think that a lot of people now have an expectation that doesn't necessarily match what the realistic vision of our current time is and in the future. But I agree with what you're saying. I think we're trying to get to that point.
All right, and so we're gonna have to wrap up here as folks are getting a bit restless. So I'd like to say, let's have a
thank you.